going to go to a little open shed in backyard chicken processing facility, or a church commercial kitchen, or some community cannery. They're going to go to these huge, the Campbell Soup or some, XL premium and standard, where there's 1,000 people in long coats that can't speak the same language, and they're all, mingling and mixing, and it's chaos, and somebody can take something. The third vulnerability is long distance transit. All of those midnight rides, not of Paul Revere, but of refrigerated tractor trailers going across Kansas and Nebraska, from California to New York. Long distance transportation. But yeah, you would think, what you think of the policymakers look at these three areas and say, you know what? We're gonna fix that. We're gonna attack these three vulnerabilities of our food system. We all agree on this. We're gonna attack these areas. We're gonna solve this problem. So let's see. What would be the opposite of centralized production? Well, that sounds like diversified family farms. All idea. Amazing. Well, what would be the opposite of centralized processing? Let's see. What would that be? That sounds almost like community canneries and on-farm processing and cottage kitchens. Yeah. Well, what would be the opposite of long-distance transportation? Sounds amazingly like local. Now, wouldn't you think that policymakers would agree if that's the problem, what the solution is? But what's their solution? Their solution is genetically modified organisms, cloning, microchipping and radio frequency identification, tagging every chicken and salamander on your farm. I think we're going to microchip something. We ought to microchip the politicians so we can find out where they are. Mandatory irradiation, these are all the answers. The next thing that needs healing, I would suggest, is the soul of our culture. See what happened is, in our agrarian culture, a lot of people were involved in being connected to the food in the agrarian culture, which gave way to the industrial economy. In the industrial economy, we learned how to pour concrete and plant rebar and build factories. And in fact, the industrial economy gave us supposedly the greatest generation the world has ever known, the World War II generation, and my parents were part of it, and I appreciate it. But you know what? In following duty, there's one thing that great generation forgot how to do in building and saving freedom and building a great merchant world power. They forgot how to cry. So busy doing their duty that they forgot how to cry when the salamanders didn't have legs anymore. And when the birds couldn't sing anymore. And of course, it culminated, one of the great examples of it was in the 1950s when our culture decided that breastfeeding babies was Neanderthal and barbaric, and we raised a generation of asthmatics on Enfamil and Similac. And then came the 1960s, and young people grew up wondering, is rebar and concrete and punching the time clock, is that all there is to life? And of course, that gave us the beaded, bearded, brawless, Woodstock, Nirvana, Back to the Land, Cosmic, Revolution. And who would have guessed in the 1950s that within a generation we would have election day? Lamont. Men would be saying, yeah,